I like it.
Thank you.
Good morning. Welcome to the worship of our Lord here at Westminster Presbyterian Church. We are glad you are with us this morning. If you're here with us in person, you can fill out the prayer request cards and they'll be collected during the second hymn. If you're here with us in person, you can also fill out the friendship pads and pass them down the pew to get to know one another. We have a few announcements this morning. The first is for our elders and current people on session. Session is meeting via Zoom today. If you did not get that link, or if you deleted that link, you can reach out to me and I will send that to you again, but that'll be today at 12:30. It is Pledge Sunday today, so I hope you brought your pledge cards. If you did not, you can bring those next week or the week after, but we would love to get those back as soon as possible. I was told I wasn't allowed to make it conditional to get communion today for your pledge cards. So, well, guests will still let you have communion, but please bring them back. Also, next Sunday, Pastor Mack, who is the minister at Grace Place Campus Minister, joining us next Sunday following worship to tell us more about the ministry that happens over at Grace Place and the work that they are doing over there. So join us after worship next week to hear more about Grace Place. I think Blake has at least one announcement.
Today you'll notice the communion wear is different, and that comes from the Oregon Presbyterian Church. It was a church that recently closed, and this was part of what was handed on to the presbytery. It is a way to remember their ministry, and since our set was kind of bunged up, it was a good thing for us to use it. So from time to time, you'll see it, and I hope you think of that congregation and what they did through the years.
Are there any other announcements this morning? We got one.
Good morning. I just wanted to remind you, as I announced last week, that this Sunday and next Sunday, we will be participating in the Bread for the World offering of letters. Loreen and I will be available in the Knox Hall after service. For anyone that is interested in participating, we will have these handouts that have sample letters on the back. So please stop by this week and next week. The Grace Place Forum that Pastor Molly alluded to will be taking place at 11:30, so you'll have time to do this next week. So the forum won't be right after worship. Okay. All right, thank you.
Let us continue our worship by standing in body or in spirit and joining in the call to worship. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth.
We will give thanks to you, Lord, with our whole heart.
We will tell of all your wonderful deeds. We will be glad and rejoice in you.
You are holy. You are mighty. You are mighty. You are worthy. You are worthy.
Please be seated. We know that nothing is able to separate us from the love of God. Let us, in freedom, confess the wrongs we have done. Let us go to God together. Gracious God, our sins are too heavy to carry, too real to hide, and too deep to undo. Forgive what our lips tremble to name, what our hearts can no longer bear, and what has become for us a consuming fire of judgment. Set us free from the past, which we cannot change. Open to us a future in which we can be changed, and grant us grace to grow more and more in your likeness and image. Through Jesus Christ, the light of the world. And all God's people say, hear the good news. God so loved the world that he gave his only son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send his son to the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Hear these words and be called to deeper faith. Trust the Lord with all your heart, and do not lean on your own understanding. Know God in all your paths, and God will keep your ways straight. Amen. Thank you. Now is the time in the service when we have a special message for the children of God. We are all called God's children, so all are invited at this time. We're even coming on the floor. Yep, come on up, guys. Hey, Miss Lindsay, how are you? Hi, Jaden. How's it going? I know, we've got some new friends today, don't we? I'm gonna wait for them, don't worry. Hello, hello, good morning. We are glad you guys are with us today. It's good to see you guys back. So we've been learning about Paul in church. And so we learned about how Paul used to be called Saul, and he used to persecute people who loved Jesus, but then Jesus came to him and he learned to love Jesus too. And then we learned about how Paul was in prison and an angel let him out, but he didn't leave prison because that would have been bad for the guard, right? And so he stayed there, and then the guard became personal of Jesus. And we're gonna hear a third story about Paul today, but there's one we missed and I want you guys to hear it. And this is about a woman named Lydia and Paul meeting Lydia. So we have Paul and we have Lydia. Let's see what happens. Paul traveled many places, teaching people about Jesus. One night, God told Paul, "Go to another country and teach people there." Paul listened to God. He got on a big boat. Up and down, over the waves, the boat went sailing to a faraway country. When he got there, Paul taught. "Jesus loves you," he said. "Jesus came to earth to teach us to live and has saved us from our sins." An amazing woman named Lydia heard Paul teaching. Unlike many other women at the time, Lydia had her own business. She sold beautiful, expensive purple cloth to rich and famous people. Lydia said to Paul, "Tell me more about Jesus. I want to learn everything there is about the Son of God." Paul told her about Jesus' teaching. "Love everyone," he said, "share with others. And most important," he reminded, "remember that God loves you forever." Lydia was amazed. "I want to be one of Jesus' followers," she exclaimed. "Will you baptize me and everyone in my household?" Lydia and Paul and all of the people who lived in Lydia's house went to the water. They splashed into the cool wetness. Paul baptized each of them. "I baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit." Lydia said, "Thank you. Will you stay at my house with me?" Paul said, "Sure," and went to stay with Lydia. Lydia became a follower of Jesus. She was very generous, using her money to help many people. "Jesus loves you," she told many people. "Jesus has saved you from his sins. Follow Jesus. He is the Son of God." Many people learned from Lydia, the amazing woman who sold purple cloth. So Paul met many, many people, and this time he met this wonderful woman who sold purple cloth. Isn't that pretty cool? Today, purple cloth is pretty easy to find, but back then it wasn't. So let's say a prayer, okay? Loving God, thank you for using ordinary people and ordinary women like Lydia, who sold purple cloth, to share the love of Jesus with everyone. May we be like Lydia, sharing the love of God and sharing what we have with one another. Amen. All right, good to see everybody. Yep, and Miss Pooja is here today if you want to go with her.
Let us unite in the prayer for illumination. O God, by your Holy Spirit, tell us what we need to hear and show us what we ought to do to obey Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Our scripture reading comes from the book of Acts. We read from chapter 17, verses 16 through 31. While Paul was waiting for them in Athens, He was deeply distressed to see that the city was full of idols. So he argued in the synagogue with the Jews and the devout persons, and also in the marketplace every day with those who happened to be there. Also, some Epicurean and Stoic philosophers debated with him. Some said, "What does this babbler want to say?" Others said, "He seems to be a proclaimer of foreign divinities." This was because he was telling the good news about Jesus and the resurrection. So they took him and brought him to the Areopagus and asked him, "May we know what this new teaching is that you are presenting? It sounds rather strange to us, so we would like to know what it means." Now all the Athenians and foreigners living there would spend their time in nothing but telling or hearing something new. Then Paul stood in front of the Areopagus, and he said, "Athenians, I see how extremely religious you are in every way. For as I went through the city and looked carefully at the objects of your worship, I found among them an altar with the inscription, 'To an unknown God.' What therefore you worship as unknown, this I proclaim to you. The God who made the world and everything in it, he who is Lord of heaven and earth, does not live in shrines made by human hands, nor is he served by human hands as though he needed anything, since he himself gives to all mortals life and breath and all things. From one ancestor he made all nations to inhabit the whole earth, and he allotted the times of their existence and the boundaries of the places where they would live, so that they would search for God and perhaps grope for him and find him, though indeed he is not far from each one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being, as even some of your own poets have said, 'For we too are his offspring.' Since we are God's offspring, we ought not to think that the deity is like gold or silver or stone, an image formed by the art and imagination of mortals. While God has overlooked the times of human ignorance, now he commands all people everywhere to repent, because he has fixed a day on which he will have the world judged in righteousness by a man whom he has appointed. And of this he has given assurance to all by raising him from the dead." Here ends the reading of the text. If you do have a prayer request, we ask that you hold it up as we sing our next hymn together.
Together on our knees.
Let us pray. Be with us, gracious God, as we come to your word. Open our hearts to receive its message. Help us think afresh about the ways you have spoken of your presence in the world. It is in Christ's name that we pray. Amen. John Polkinghorne was both an Anglican priest and a theoretical physicist. He was instrumental in the work that proved the existence of quarks, and I even have no idea what that means or does, but he did that, and he also worked hard to sort of look at the relationship between faith and science, because it was, to him, such an elemental issue as how we looked at the world. He spent the first part of his career working on theoretical physics stuff, whatever that is. And then he went into a parish, and he served there for a number of years, and he finally wound up serving as a pastor at a university setting, as a chaplain there. What he wanted to point out in regard to the interface between God and the world was how important it was that human beings actually have a choice in the matter of how they live their lives, and that these choices, when added together, will have consequences. And so you take a look at the evil that exists in the world. Well, you take a look at war in Ukraine, and you look at the consequences of human choice, and you see all the way the evil plays out in how those choices have been. And were it not for the possibility of these choices, what could the relationship be between humanity and God? If God just treated us all like puppets, how could there be any sort of real connection between ourselves and between God? And he would take this argument a step further, and he would go on to say that just as God created these possibilities in the human world, possibilities in which real consequences exist, he would argue the same thing exists in the physical world. And he took as an example one of the classic problems of good and evil in the Enlightenment. And that was what happened in the earthquake in Lisbon in 1755. It was on November 1st. It was All Saints' Day. The churches were full. And the earthquake came, and it literally dropped every church in town. They just became piles of rubble. Churches that were filled with people celebrating the events of All Saints' Day. It was a time when people went to church a lot. And after the earthquake, then something odd will happen in the port of Lisbon, and that is the water will get sucked out of the port. And all the ships that were there suddenly become wrecks, and then they could see into all the wrecked ships that had been there before. I mean, all the water had been sucked out temporarily, and little did they know that it was going to be followed by a tsunami. And so this is one of the great catastrophes in certainly the country of Portugal. And one of the great catastrophes in the world as far as earthquakes go. The estimates range from 12,000 to 50,000 people died on that day. The city would eventually be consumed by fires, as, you know, everybody had cooking fires, and suddenly everything gets knocked over and those fires spread throughout the town. By the end of the day, there was little of Lisbon left. And as Polkinghorne works with this tragic event, he goes on to say that just as God has created humanity and given us the power to make a choice and given us a chance to act according to our nature, there's a way in which the world itself acts according to its own nature. And just like it would somehow rob the world of its capacity to be if God just micromanaged every moment. So when the tectonic plates shift, there will be the consequences of those actions. And that's just part of how creation is made. Well, it gives us a lot to think about, at least, and it gives us certainly gives us pause on a day in which, once again, human evil has become so apparent. The tragic events yesterday in Buffalo just once again touched the wounds of this community as we think of our own experience with a shooting. I remember visiting with somebody from Presbyterian Disaster Assistance in my office, and with great sadness realized how well prepared they were to come into towns where a shooting had taken place. That these events had become so commonplace that they came with hymns and liturgies. They knew what to do. And they knew what this experience was like. So the big questions about how we live in this world, how we are connected to God, how the world relates to God, well, those are big questions that have been addressed throughout the ages. And as the Apostle Paul comes into Athens, he comes to a place where those big questions have been thought of since sort of the beginning of modern history. Athens has been at the forefront of philosophical considerations. And what makes this so odd and so difficult for the apostle is how the city had become a place that was just filled with various kinds of religious traditions. There was an actual criterion for how you got a permission to build the temple in Athens, and that was you pretty much had to prove that your God was at work in Athens and that that God intended something good for the city. And if you could do that, then yeah, build your shrine, that'd be okay. Okay, so as Paul is addressing this crowd that has kind of looked at these questions of human existence, it mentions there were Stoics and Epicurean philosophers. We have our own meanings attached to these words, but it's worth reading the Wikipedia articles to notice how far our own understandings of what it means to be Stoic actually differs from what the Stoics thought it meant to be Stoic. That's a little homework. There'll be a quiz next week. And you thought finals were over. All right. So As Paul is addressing the crowd and bringing up the issue of who Jesus Christ was and how God had interacted with the earth, he does so by saying, you know, we've got some common ground. We have some things we could talk about here and should talk about together about what God has been up to. And that kind of discussion seems like the very essence of what our faith should be about. We ought to be considering what God is up to and what God is busy about in the world. And this is where the whole story of Jesus Christ and the resurrection comes into play for Paul. As someone who had personally encountered Jesus Christ on the road to Damascus, and in that personal encounter had come to understand the purpose of his own life in a fresh way. In Acts, we have that same sort of missionary opportunity that Paul received is now given to the people of Athens. And while many could not comprehend what was so significant about what he had to say, the story ends with a recognition of a couple of people, Dionysius, Damaris, a couple of people who became part of starting the church in Athens. Paul's discussion about God being at work, Paul's willingness to take on the great themes that existed in philosophical inquiry at the time, should serve as a reminder to us, just as Polkinghorne's work serves as a reminder, that there are places where not all questions are answered or even addressed by what goes on in scientific inquiry. Just doesn't work like that. In fact, its whole focus is in something different than what the religious enterprise is about. It's not that they don't sometimes intersect or have things to talk about, and that is true. They do intersect at times. But that to work out your whole meaning of life exists apart from a discussion about who God is, well, Paul wants to say, wait a minute. And this is a place where we can say to ourselves, wait a minute, what have I allowed to take over my life? And what is so important to me that I govern my life on those terms? What's the big deal that I want to focus my attention on? Well, there are so many places for us to go astray in the modern world. There are so many places for us to lose our sense of what our focus is, to follow all the things that the world has out there to offer to us, all the shiny, glittery possibilities of either accumulation, of consumerism, of pride, of achievement. All of these things can become, in their own way, while they can be good in their self, in their own way, they can sort of be a way that we become derailed, that we lose our direction, and we somehow think that our decisions are more important than the decision that God has made on our behalf in Jesus Christ. What are the false gods that would show up in our own pantheons? What are the false gods that we would pursue? And so Paul puts that question to the Athenians, and he puts it to us. How have we lost our way? How have we pursued things that have nothing to do with our faith? Polk Buckinghorn has written like 7 religious books and, I don't know, 5 major treatises on his work in theoretical physics. And I got to hear him speak one time, and he had a whole collection of his books there, and I looked for the thinnest one. And the title was Quarks, Chaos, and Christianity. And I just love that title. And as we think about the chaos in the world around us and the ways that we wander from what God would have us be, may we seek the core of God's message to us in Jesus Christ. Seek the core that exists in the possibility of finding a way to love. You know, once again, we have seen the power of hate in the world and just the appalling way that hate took over this man's life and became for him a reason to travel hours to a city he didn't know to shoot strangers. And the gospel becomes a way for us to say, even to people caught up in the midst of hate, there is one who loves you, who can move you in a different way. And for us to bear witness to that, and for us to hold on to that love and share that love, becomes such a primary task in this world that I can think of few other things more important. To bear witness to the one who gives us assurance about God's purpose. That is so key to our life and so key to the way we live in this world. Let's stand up and affirm our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. Let us now offer our gifts to God.
Let us pray. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, maker of all things. Through your goodness, you have blessed us with these gifts. With them, we offer ourselves to your service and dedicate our lives to the care and redemption of all that you have made, for the sake of him who gave himself for us, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Friends, this is the joyful feast of the people of God. People will come from north and south and from east and west to sit at table in the kingdom of God. According to Luke, when our risen Lord was at table with his disciples, he took the bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened and they recognized him. This is the Lord's table. Our Savior invites those who trust him to share the feast that he has prepared.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
In every time and every age, O God, it is good and faithful that we give you thanks. For your mercy is sure and your steadfast love endures forever. In your compassion, you gave us Jesus Christ, who set us free from death and leads us to eternal life. And so with all creation, with all the needy and hungry ones, with those who have enough and plenty, with creatures large and small, with sun and moon and stars, and with saints of every age, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna.
Blessed are you, O God, creator of all things. By your power and love, you continue to deliver your people from bondage, thwart the designs of evil, show the way through the wilderness, turn hardship into righteousness, and reveal your hand upholding the just. Blessed are you, O Christ, servant of the universe. You came among us to feed and heal and teach, to confound the haughty, to confuse the deceivers, to challenge the wrong-hearted, and in all these things, to give hope to those who long for peace. Remembering our Lord's self-giving love, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Blessed are you, O Spirit, giver of life. You give us words when we have none. You fill us with visions when we have the most need. You give us voice to proclaim our faith in every hour. Be our guide and teacher today and always. Holy God, we pray for the world, for a world in chaos and turmoil. We pray for Ukraine and the war that is happening there. May your peace be upon them. We pray for the families of the victims in the shooting in Buffalo, and we pray for the safety of that community. Lord, your words tell us that there will be a day where swords will be beaten to plowshares. May our weapons of violence be used to create life, not to take it away. We pray for successful semesters, for the ending of the school year, for all of those who prepare for the summer, for some rest and relaxation, hopefully. Come now, O Prince of Peace, Spirit of Love, Breath of Life. Bring to all this hurting world the joy that Mary knew, and teach us to proclaim with her, "I have seen the Lord," in the unity of the Holy Trinity, in the gratitude for this day, great day of resurrection. We praise you, God of all that is, now and forever. Amen.
And now, with the confidence of the children of God, let us pray the prayer that Christ has taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation,
but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Hear the words of institution of the Holy Supper of our Lord Jesus Christ. On the night of his arrest, Jesus sat at table with disciples, and he took the bread, and after giving thanks to God, he broke it. And he said, "This is my body broken for you. Take and eat of it, all of you. Do this in remembrance of me."
In the same way, Jesus took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me."
Let us pray. Living Christ, as you open the scriptures to us, you make yourself known in this breaking of bread. Let us now go forth from this place, fed at your table and filled by the Spirit, to walk with you all the days of our lives, proclaim the glory of your resurrection to all the world. Amen. Amen.
And now go out into the world in peace. Hold fast to that which is good. Give to no one evil for evil. Support the weak, strengthen the faint-hearted. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit abide with each one of you from this time forth and forevermore. And all God's people say,